Good afternoon, comrades. So I was going to say that we won't be discussing Brexit in this discussion, except to say I'm very, very sorry for getting it wrong. Those who've read my blog will know that I made three predictions 2 years ago, I think it was. First, that the Tories would win the election. Second, Scotland would vote to stay in the UK. And the one that I was most confident about was that the UK would vote to stay in the European Union. So in order to avoid any more embarrassment, we're not going to talk about that in my discussion. And in fact, we're going to look at some of the longer-term issues that are facing the world economy, and for that matter, capitalism. And one of the most important aspects of capital accumulation is the drive to introduce new technology, new methods to reduce costs, to reduce the amount of labour time involved, and to reduce costs for capitalism. One of the most important technological developments that have been taking place over the last 15 to 20 years is the development of robots, and in particular, artificial intelligence. And there are two questions I want to bring up in this discussion, which is first, are robots and artificial intelligence, AI, set to take over the world of work and thus the economy in the next generation? And what does this mean for jobs and living standards for people? And secondly, will it mean a socialist utopia in our time, the end of human toil, a superabundance of goods in a harmonious society, or a capitalist dystopia, more intense crises, more conflict, more unemployment, more toil alongside joblessness? So those are the questions. That's the story that I want to briefly discuss. Now, the use of robots is dramatically increasing. Here's a few of the babies. As we'll find out perhaps a bit later, robots aren't just physical things, but actually just basically software and intelligence that can be built into computers and any device in order to deliver a result so much more quickly than human beings can. But in 2015, last year, global sales of industrial robots increased to almost 240,000 units a year. The third year in a row that had been at a record. The automotive industry and the electronics industry, as this picture shows, are where most of that robotic automation is taking place. Asia in particular was the main driver of growth. China is now one of the leading robot producers. And North America still remains the front runner in the automation area. Robot sales up 11% last year in the North America and 8% in Europe. So in the last decade, the level of robotic use has doubled in the top economies. Japan and Korea have the most robots per employee in manufacturing, over 300 per 10,000 employees, robots now of this type, followed by Germany. The United States is well behind those countries in the adoption rate. I won't tell you where Britain is, but you can imagine it's pretty far down the list. Now, people have been making estimates about how long it will be before we're in the position where there are more robots producing all of the commodities and things that we need in the world compared to human beings. And using a simple compound calculator on the rates of increase in robots now and what they produce, some people have come up with a figure in something like, in 25 years, parity will be introduced and we'll have a position where robots are producing more in billions of autonomous units than human beings. That's the implication of where we're going with this new form of technology. By 2035, in this case, possibly a little later, it's been estimated that robots will take over and be the leading producer of all autonomous units in the world. Now, we generally live, on average, not an average, about 70 years. I should be getting that next year, so we'll see whether I go beyond the average. Robots have a life expectancy only of close to 10 years, so it needs about 7 times more robots per year in order to have the same number as humans will be reaching in the early 2050s. So that shows the level of increase that robots have got to get in order to deliver this sort of extra production. There may be more of them, but they don't last as long, surprisingly, as human beings at the moment. However, That situation could well be changing. And certainly, it's estimated now that by about 2070, where the robots will not own, will be in the position where they're outnumbering humans by 10 to 1. And so that ratio of life expectancy will be covered by the number of robots in the world. But robots aren't just physical things. Artificial intelligence, the use of software and methods by which robots learn from their experience and therefore can contribute to developing their understanding and raising their level of intelligence as best we understand it, is exactly what the nature of this new technology is. One of the big features at the moment is already around is that software has now started to make decisions on our behalf. Recently, as I come close to the investment world and I'm able to see the insides of finance capital quite a lot, some hedge funds have now got a board where they decide whether they're going to invest in this particular country or whether they're going to short the pound to make some money as it collapses or whatever their beneficial to human society decision is. But around this board, they now have an algorithm and that gets a vote. So the chief executive gets a vote, the finance director gets a vote, and an algorithm gets the vote. And it's 2-1, and the algorithm may decide that you should do this. This is the direction which is already being introduced in various financial sectors. Now, there is a nasty side of the development of robots. And it's the idea that we're going to have an evil robotic world which will go out to kill human beings as these clever clogs robots wander around the world, not only in providing things for us, but making sure that we're put in our place. This has been a view expressed by a number of so-called experts on this. Susan Schneider, professor of philosophy at the University of Connecticut, has said that it's probably likely that all alien intelligence is that, robots. There aren't living beings as we understand it, in whatever form they are, organisms. They're all robots because the level of artificial intelligence must have exponentially, infinitely increased in the more advanced parts of the universe. And so probably they're robots in some form or just algorithms of the whole world, whole universes. The reason that we don't know that is because they've ignored us. We're so primitive that they've just passed us by, so she says. Now, that's a bit of a science fiction, but nevertheless, it's something which is now being pushed as the extreme example of where we're going within the direction of robots and artificial intelligence. I'll come back to Mr. Keynes in a minute. He's not a robot. But if we come back to ground again, back to Earth, from away from the War of the Worlds and that image, it's become clear that a number of studies are now being done on the level of impact that the introduction of robots, artificial intelligence and other Internet of Things and all these new technologies will do to the level of employment around the world. Now, two Oxford economists looked at the likely impact of technological change in 702 occupations, including probably many of those that you already have sitting in this room today. And they concluded that 47% of those occupations would be replaced by robots or other artificial intelligence, and so those jobs would basically disappear over the next 20 years, they reckon. 47% of the jobs that people do now would disappear and be replaced by the use of robots, according to their estimate. So the question is, before us, the second question I proposed, is this great news? Does this mean that we'll all be working less, be much more production going on of services and things that we need? Or is it the end of a creation of an even more unequal, a more destructive society with poor and rich divided even further and many people living in a state of destitution throughout their lives? Now, you can take two views on this. Those of you who have read Paul Mason's book, Post-Capitalism, where he develops a lot of the ideas and the trends that we've seen here, he says that technology, these technological developments are going to be liberating for society because the opportunity for to blur the difference between work, going between 9 and 5, or whatever it is on shifts, to the level where we spend a little bit of time working on our computer, a little bit of, and much more time just doing other things to enrich our lives. In other words, the hours of work are going to be reduced through the expansion of this new technology. And this will hugely diminish the amount of work needed, but also still provide a decent life for all. And you can see that if we have machines and other parts of this whole process of technology that can dramatically increase the things that we need and use in our lives, that should, by any definition, mean a reduction in the amount of hours that we have to spend in toil. But will the information revolution mean less work? Will it mean deliver a decent life, a world without toil? Now, Keynes was at a lecture in 1931, a bit like this. His audience was composed of people like Boris Johnson in 1931, and from the Bullingdon Club. All the Cambridge students were there, and he made a lecture because he was very, very worried that all these very privileged students were actually thinking in 1931, in the depths of the recession, the depths of the Great Depression, that maybe Marxism and communism was a better solution to the world than what capitalism's offered. Yes, I know some of us students thought that, certainly in 1931. And so he was right. So he made a speech and he said, he argued the case. Look, capitalism can develop technology. Technology will deliver a much increased amount of superabundance over the next 30 and 100 years. And he predicted that on that basis of a world of superabundance, the hours of work will be dramatically decreased. The problem for people will no longer be a problem of toil, but a problem of what to do with themselves in terms of leisure. So he told the students, don't worry, we're in the depths of the Depression, but with the right policies and with the future which the top capitalist economies can do with new technology, all will be well. Well, as I can see here, here's a picture of what happened in 1930. You can see that the level of work, this is hours, weekly hours worked at the time on average in the US, down at the depth of the recession, it was pretty low anyway. Then we saw during the war, of course, everybody was working intensely for the war effort in order to ensure that democracy was saved from Hitler. And then we had the period of the Golden Age, where it appears that maybe Keynes's view is correct, that there was going to be a sharp reduction in hours. But from the neoliberal period, we've seen again a rise in the amount of toil. So in the period where we had this new technology beginning to come into operation, the internet and so on, actually the hours of weekly hours worked have increased in the recent period. So there is a great contradiction here. There's a contradiction between the superabundance, which robots and artificial intelligence and the new technology can deliver, and how it is to be controlled and distributed. If capital remains in control, then can we expect that toil will be reduced, or can we just expect that everybody will lose their jobs, or 47% of existing occupations will disappear as a result? Well, in 1980, the average hours worked in most of the advanced countries in a year was 1,800. In 2015, the average hours worked in a year in the advanced countries was 1,800. So far, over the last 30 or so years, there's been no change in that situation. And we haven't seen any significant change in the level of hours of work as a result. And so I would ask myself that maybe we need to look a little deeper at what's going on in this process of technological change. Now, the essence of capitalist accumulation is to increase profits and accumulate more capital. Capitalists want to introduce machines that can boost the productivity of each employee and reduce costs compared to competitors. That's the great revolutionary role of capitalism in developing the productive forces available to society. But there's a contradiction. In trying to raise the productivity of labour with the introduction of technology, there is a process of labour shedding. New technology replaces labour, Yes, increased productivity might lead to increased output and open up new sectors, new jobs to compensate. But over time, there is a capital bias or a labour shedding, and that means that new value is created, less new value is created, as labour is the only form, relative to the cost of invested capital. So there's a tendency, as accumulation takes place, for profitability for the stock of investment made by capitalists to fall, even though productivity is rising. In turn, that leads to a crisis in production and halts and even reverses the gain in production from new technology. Now, what does this mean if we enter an extreme future? Let us say robotic technology and AI leads to robots making robots and more robots extracting the raw materials and making everything and carrying out all the services so that human labour does no longer need at all. We no longer require any human labour, and robots do everything, creating more robots for any task of production or service at all. Now, this is an extreme example. Let's imagine then a total automated process where no human worked in the production process. Surely, value has been added. There are more things. There's conversion of raw materials into goods, even without humans. Does this refute Marx's idea that value only comes from labour? But that confuses the dual nature of value, use value and exchange value. There is use value, things and services that people need, and exchange value, the value measured in labour time and appropriated by human labour by the owners, from human labour by the owners of capital and realised by sale on the market. In every commodity under the capitalist mode of production, there is both use value and exchange value. You can't have one without the other under capitalism. But the latter rules the capitalist investment and production process, and value in that sense is specific to capitalism. Sure, living labour can create more things and services, but value is the substance of the capitalist mode of production. So capital controls the means of production created by labour and only put them to use and to appropriate value created by labour. So in our hypothetical, all-encompassing robot world, that would mean productivity of use values would go towards infinity, while profitability, the value appropriated by capitalists, would go towards zero. In that sense, a robotic world, in that sense, is not capitalism. That's a very important point that we must consider. It's not capitalism. It's more analogy with a slave economy, really. And if we imagine the slave economy in ancient Rome, over hundreds of years, the smallholding peasant was replaced by slaves in mining, farming, and all sorts of other tasks. This happened because the booty of successful wars that the Roman Republic and Empire conducted included a mass supply of slave labour. So the cost of slave owners of slaves was reduced to a very low level compared with employing free labour or using peasants. So the slave owners drove the farmers off their land through a combination of debt demands, requisitioning wars, and sheer violence. Class struggle didn't end, but the class struggle was between the slave-owning aristocrats and the slaves, and between the aristocrats and the atomized peasants now living in the cities as plebeians. So a fully robot economy means that the owners of the means of production, robots, would have a superabundant economy of things at zero costs. Their owners can then just consume. They don't need to make a profit, just as slave owners in Rome didn't just consume and did not run businesses to sell commodities to make a profit. So a robotic economy would mean a superabundant world for all, or it could mean a new form of slave society, society with extreme equality of wealth and income. It's a social choice, or more accurately, it depends on the outcome of the class struggle. We could end up with a robotic world controlled by a few monopoly owners and the rest of us just plebs in the Roman style, or we could have a world where the cooperation of the whole of the human race goes towards using that superabundance for other things. So let me come back to the here and now. Just how good at the moment are robots? How close are we to the choice between dystopia and utopia? Naturally, we can see out in Asia, they're already serving up something that doesn't look edible to the people in the unnamed McDonald's, whatever it is. You can see the robot at the back there. I think that was, it looks like a female. I think they're both female robots. So they're waitresses. Now, AI researchers noted that the simplest tasks for humans, such as reaching into a pocket to retrieve a quarter, is very, very difficult for a machine like that. For example, iRobot's Roomba robot is autonomous, but the vacuuming task it performs by wandering around rooms, that's pretty simple. By contrast, a company's PackBot is more expensive because it's designed to defuse bombs, but it must be teleoperated and controlled by people from wireless. So there's still a connection between the human beings and the level of robotic technology we have at the moment. Now, in America, the Pentagon held a robotics challenge competition in California, $2 million prize money for anybody who could produce a robot that could do better than in a series of rescue-oriented tasks in under an hour than a human being could do. The robots had an hour to complete a set of 8 tasks, which would probably take a human less than 10 minutes. And the robots failed at every task, nowhere near 10 minutes, nowhere near within 1 hour. Most of the robots were two-legged, well, not two-legged, but many had 4 legs or wheels or everything. They couldn't maneuver very well either. So none were autonomous, and the human operators still had to guide them with wireless networks and so on. And this is as far as we've got in terms of replacing human beings to some of these more difficult tasks that that human beings still do, like the one up on the screen there. So there's still a long way to go. Now, David Graeber, who wrote The History of Debt and others, has said that not only are they still well behind, the fact is that the capitalist system blocks, really, the development of these robots, because most of the robotic technology is not in the direction of providing better things and services for the majority of the population. As he said, people used to imagine they'd have flying cars, teleportation devices and robots. We're just about to get to driverless cars, I think, although Telstra today had a bit of a problem when the guy who was sitting in his car was having a kip and the car went straight into a huge tractor for the first fatal death on a driverless car because the car did not recognise the tractor. It was thought it was some sort of grey horizon and didn't distinguish between the two. Nevertheless, remember that the amount of deaths caused under driverless cars is still well less than those driven by you. But we've still got, it seems, a long way to go. The one reason we don't have robot factories yet at the level that are required to meet that sort of target that we saw of the expansion of robots against human beings is that roughly 95% of robotics research funding in the US goes through the Pentagon and is aimed mainly at producing unmanned drones rather than developing automated production for things that most people need. William Nordhaus at Yale University has tried to estimate the future impact that AI and robots will have, and he thinks there's a long way to go. We may all love our iPhones, in my case the fast-disappearing BlackBerry, but they cannot eat electronic output. Similarly, today's technologies require a lot of scarce input stuff in the form of labour, energy, natural resources that are eating into the environment and adding towards the problems we have in climate change in order to produce the new robots and the new technology. Nordhaus says that projecting the trends of the last decade, it will be more like a century before we could talk about robots taking over in a big way from human beings' tasks. So you have the choice. The researchers say on the one hand it's 10 to 15 years and half our jobs are gone. Nordhaus says no, it'll be towards the end of the 21st century, even at current paces. So we have an issue there. We have two issues. One, whether robots are going to hit us and really change the situation, and also what that means in terms of control of the means of production, in terms of developing the productivity. Now, as long as means of production, and that includes robots, are owned by a few, the benefits of a robot society will accrue to the few. Whoever owns the capital benefits most from the robots and can replace jobs without replacing themselves. If the rewards of the new technologies go largely to the very richest, then the dystopian future that I've outlined is most likely. Will it be the right or will it be the left? Now, John Lanchester, who's looked at this, he says, it seems to me that the only way that the world would work is with alternative forms of ownership. The only reason for thinking this better world is possible is that the dystopian future of capitalism plus robots will be just too grim to be politically viable. The alternative future will be a kind of world dreamed of by William Morris, full of humans engaged in meaningful, sanely remunerated labour, except with robots to help them. It says a lot about the current moment that we face in this future, that we have a choice between a hyper-capitalist dystopia or a socialist paradise. And the second option gets no mention at all from those that control the robots at the moment. Now, Paul Mace is more optimistic. He said, he reminds us in his book, Post-Capitalism, that Engels said in 1880 that it's possible now for technology to secure for every member of society by means of socialized production an existence not only fully sufficient materially and becoming day by day more full, but an existence guaranteeing to all the free and development and exercise of their physical and mental faculties. This possibility is now for the first time here in 1880. Well, that is triply, quadruply, and 10 times more possible now with the technology we have in 2016. Mason says that then we could perhaps gradually move to this superabundant post-capitalist society. But he recognised there is a contradiction. Paul's contradiction is between what he sees as the free, abundant goods and information, a system of monopolies and banks trying to keep it private. It comes down to, in his view, a struggle between the internet network and the hierarchy, between the old forms of society and the new. I've not been able to quite grasp what he means by the network, but I have an image of myself in my pyjamas at 2 o'clock in the morning on the net, pressing the button to vote for Corbyn. And that seemed to be the way of thing that he was proposing that we would change things. I have a doubt about that. Perhaps that's probably an unfair description of what he's arguing for, but it's not clear. It seems to me we haven't really changed the basic contradiction of the nature of the class struggle between capital and labour. And it's not between monopolies and free networking, but still between capital and labour. And that the old-fashioned industrial proletariat is still out there. I've been at a debate and imperialism workshop just this Monday where John Smith in his new book points out that the global proletariat is larger than it's ever been in the history of capitalism. So nearly hitting something like, well over something like 2 billion, I think, altogether, global proletariat at the moment. That's never been bigger. But of course, most of that global proletariat is not in countries like the UK and the US, the major economies. The proletariat, and just the industrial proletariat, which is an underestimate of the working class, as we know, is pretty much flat. But all the huge increase has been taking place in the emerging economies. So there are millions more people. The world is now, the majority of people in the world now live in an urban environment, not in a rural environment. That's a dramatic change that's taken place in the 20th century. And the majority, and the urban proletariat and the industrial proletariat has never been larger. That tells me that there's still a force for changing in society and that robots don't have to be our enemy if we have an associated production, a common ownership of production, and that force for change remains the proletariat, not some sort of other unclear, mystical network.
Hi, it's Tim from Norwich. I just wanted to make 3 points. The first was about automation in here and now, not in the future. I work in insurance, and what they're trying to do in insurance, I recently got a new job. I wrote a letter into the Socialist Review, and they responded really quickly about this big concern. What they want to do in insurance is what they've done in banking, is they want to automate it. They want to make it so the different tasks that lots of these big workplaces, finance, they have to employ thousands of workers to do the administration, to run the insurance, to run banking. What they want to do is replace all of that, or their aim is to do that, with algorithms to do, if you want to change your address, if you want to change a policy. They're trying to introduce this, and we had a meeting with management, and the management said, don't worry, your jobs are going to be safe. And I kind of panicked. People in the room afterwards had got their phones out and started showing clips of the Terminator laughing at us as they stole our jobs. So I really liked this meeting. But I wanted to say two other things, which is it is determined about what we do, because if in that workplace and that industry, if we just let it happen, then it could be quite bad. But if we fight back, we can defend jobs. That's the first thing. The second thing to say is that machines don't work as well as they're meant to. We already have an algorithm that's supposed to run a lot of our services. We have something called Opus, which tracks the amount of work we do. And the thing is always bloody crashing all the time, and it causes massive bottlenecks. Sometimes in the day, I end up sitting at a computer doing nothing, but hours at an end sometimes, in banking and finance, because the machines don't actually work as well as they're supposed to, and they need the workforce to come in and actually run them. The other point was a comrade from Norwich. They have friends who work in one of the big car factories. And even though the workforce is much reduced, it's actually more powerful because the bosses of car factories with those types of robots, they need the workforce to run them. The robots won't run on their own. They're not automated in that sense. That was my second point. And the last point, which is a bit going off direction, which is if we get to a stage where robots are so sophisticated, they're almost like humans, would we have a socialist worker thing with a worker and a robot hand in hand saying, workers and robots unite and fight? Because if they make robots like us, they're just workers, aren't they?
Okay, thank you, comrade. And then it will be you. Yeah.
Cool. Wait, sneak a bit lower. Yeah. So I'm Andriana from Haringey Branch. I wanted to talk about alien robots for a bit. So as you said at the beginning, there is like the concept around that if there are alien things, then form of robots. And I wanted to kind of present the idea that while, you know, there is this whole concept of robots taking over our jobs, it isn't something that can be artificially, I guess, produced to a standard that we can use right now, which is what the previous speaker said, that while it's potentially something that can happen, it's something that we just don't have the technology to do right now. However, in the context of like alien robots, it's something that can happen just, I guess, hold on. All right, so the reason we exist is amino acids, and amino acids are, you know, basic elements, and those basic elements can produce anything. The probability of us actually existing is the same as the probability of a bunch of car pieces just falling together and making a car. So what I'm trying to say is that if something has the likelihood of producing itself at that such a low rate, then for us, in terms of worrying about robots taking over our jobs, even with capitalism as the driving force for just doing that, and it is really, really highly unlikely. And even if it does happen, it would be gradual. So I guess I wanted to just put across the point that we shouldn't necessarily worry about, you know, capitalism doing a thing with robots and taking over our jobs. Not right now, anyway. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. And the next we'll have you there.
Yeah. Dave Sewell, socialist worker. I appreciate the work that, Michael, you've done in sort of bringing a dose of rigor and reality to the fantasies of the likes of Paul Mason. I think that's very important. But at the same time, if I understood correctly, I think I do have a disagreement with some of what you said about the concept of a fully automated society and the class basis it could have. And I think it's important because it ties into the sort of broader debates. I mean, people will have heard the slogan fully automated luxury communism, I imagine, is something that gets raised quite a lot. I don't think it's something that's possible to talk about fully automated communism. If production is entirely in the hands of machines, then all humans are just parasites, economically speaking. And I think that takes away what makes us, you know, what gives us the class basis of workers. is our collective production. I don't think you can have collective consumption in the same way. I think actually in such a society, it would definitely tend towards the dystopian monopolies. And really, the alternative you'd sort of support would be the Romans, the robots overthrowing the useless humans. I think in reality, we have to think about work in different ways. There's work under capitalism and under class society more generally, which is when our activity is alienated and it's put under the control of the bosses and, more broadly speaking, the logic of capital. But that's not the only thing we mean by work. And, you know, when Marx talks about work, it's of our activity to transform the environment we're in. That's something, insofar as there is a Marxist concept of human nature, of course it's complicated, but that's constitutive of what we are as humans. And what we want for communism is taking control, conscious control, conscious agency of that transformation. And I think technology, obviously, can be a huge boon in that. But I don't think it's that we want technology to take away the hassle of transforming the world so that we can live in luxury. I think it's that we want to wield the powers that capitalism currently alienates from us. Let's use that technology to create great art, great literature, to colonize the outer planets, to do things that we haven't even dreamed of yet within the confines of capitalist society. It's possible you agree with all that, but I think it's important because the demands for fully automated luxury communism and some of the immediate demands that flow from that, the debate about universal basic income, I think throw more confusion than usefulness in the debates about what we do. I think it takes the focus away from taking control of our own labour and of the means of production. I hope I haven't done a complete straw man, but I think some of those debates are worth teasing out.
Okay, thank you. After this, comrade, we'll have yourself there.
I sort of read an interesting article a few weeks ago, Stephen Hawking in AI. He's saying about meaning the end of humanity. Sorry, to me, that's a realm of science fiction, because ever since Mary Shelley wrote Frankenstein, the monster or the autonomous destroys the creator. Something tells me that looking at everything that we do and everything that we've discovered, I think we're a little more clever than that. And I think what we need to do is when we look at it is look at the way that we use it for our class, what it can do for us, what it can do for us in education, what it can do for us in leisure, and what time it will give us to grow. How many people are working so hard they haven't got time for their hobbies or haven't got time for their families? How many kids are in school that the parents are tearing their hairs out because all the strain they're under because of all this crap that keeps coming up? If we are going to have robots and the development of it, we need to take control of that. We need to take control of it from capital for ourselves.
Thank you. So after this speaker, we'll have yourself.
Yes, I also am very sceptical about a fully automated economy. And the reasons are, I think my reasons are partly philosophical. I was very impressed by a book by a mainstream philosopher called Daniel Dennett, called Consciousness Explained, in which he, in particular, is comparing how computers work and how the human mind works. And he says that what a computer does is to speed up, sometimes immensely fast, some simple repetitive process. And, there are complexities to that. You know, why do computers beat humans at chess? Because given the kind of powers of computers, it's relatively easy to plot all the alternative moves in a rule-governed game like chess. What Dennett says the human mind does is not serially do the same thing according to some rule, slower than a computer. It involves a combination of different processes that interact with each other, so that there's a qualitative difference between a computer and a robot is, you know, a physically realized computer, essentially, and what the human mind does. Now, It seems to me that that difference is important, because one of the things that's characteristic of human labour is that we can do new things. We can imagine different ways of doing things. We can address unexpected situations. I mean, you know, whatever these hedge funds, you know, may say about their boards of directors, at the minute, there are lots and lots of companies, company boards, that are sitting around and saying, my God, what are we going to do now because of Brexit? There's no set of rules that can tell them what they're going to do, because the complexities are simply too great. They have to go beyond the existing situation in a way that it doesn't seem to me a robot is going to be able to help. That doesn't mean that robotization isn't an enormous danger to different kinds of work, but I simply think the obstacles to robots acquiring the kind of complex and creative intelligence that human beings have just isn't, you know, I think the difficulties are enormous, and just the kind of extrapolations we get about robotization don't address those kinds of issues. Let me just say finally, I'm not saying this in a sentimental way. We human beings are really great, we're so creative and so on. Human creativity came up with the Holocaust. It came up with nuclear weapons. So I'm not saying that human intelligence is necessarily nice, but it seems to me it's qualitatively different what is happening with these robots. The other thing I just want to say is that I thought those images of the robot waitresses are fascinating, because they show how in this supposedly brave new world, all sorts of gendered and sexist and so on, as you know, views of the world are then projected onto this machine, these machines. So this isn't a world beyond capitalism. It's a further ramification of the system that we need to destroy.
Okay, and after yourself, we'll have you there in the burgundy shirt.
A couple of points and then like a question, really. I think that it's important to point out that actually even in a robot dystopia or potentially utopia, human labour would actually still be required both to build the robots and service the robots. I know obviously people say that maybe you could get a robot that would make other robots, but I think in all likeliness you would still need human labour in order to build robots and service them. So actually I think that robots in that form can be regarded as a form of dead labour, actually. I think that, yes, if, you know, the development or the continuation of the development of robotics under capitalism does certainly have the potential to lead to a dystopia. To be honest, I think capitalism has the potential to do that on its own anyway. But I have to say, I'm actually generally for progressing or progress in the forces of production, and including through technological advance. I think that it's good if you know, robots can take over meaningless and menial tasks from humans. But I think Michael's right. I think that capitalism's actually holding back the development of robotics in that sense. I think that capitalism's acting definitely as a fetter on the forces of production in that sense. But I mean, with regard to jobs, this puts us in a quite difficult position as Marxists, because on the one hand, we are for the progress or the advance of the forces of production. On the other hand, we want to protect workers' jobs. So I guess the question really is what is the correct way actually for Marxists to respond in the example of, okay, for example, they had the thing on TfL, didn't they, driverless trains. I mean, there's a very good argument that actually they wouldn't be safe, which I think is definitely, you know, we'd agree with. But, you know, in other similar circumstances, what is the correct way actually for Marxists to respond to, because obviously then the bosses paint us as people who are, you know, we're against progress and we're living in the past and we're backwards and all this kind of stuff. What actually is the correct way to respond to that? Thank you.
I wanted to go back on the point about Frankenstein. I think it's very interesting that one of the real underlying themes of the whole of Frankenstein is that people are driven to create something that they are then unable to control, and you know his life becomes destroyed by the monster because he's created it because of a blind ambition, a blind desire. And And this is essentially something which is inherent within the nature of capitalism. And I find it quite ridiculous that society seems to have failed to learn the lesson of Frankenstein 150 years later. There are loads of films that come out, like Terminator, with people being destroyed by robots, which is essentially repeating exactly the same theme of Frankenstein. The same process, the same lesson, and yet people still seem to have a general idea that this is something which is a real possibility, and that's because society has failed to move on beyond just blindly following ideas that essentially have no basis in humanity, no basis in considering what's really important, what's really necessary. I think there is a very real danger of increased robotization destroying life as we know it one way or another, whether they would be able to have the same capacities as humans is uncertain, but it's certainly pushing towards destroying society. But this is something which is inherent within capitalism. Capitalism itself pushes towards its own destruction. And I think that increased mechanization is just a further extension of that. And what's really important is how we actually deal with it. And finding a way to get people to work together to overcome it, to realize that the whole system, the whole ideological basis of it is flawed, and to work against it.
Okay, so after this, comrades, we'll have you.
Yeah, I think it's worth, first of all, thanking the speaker for opening up. This is an interesting, I think, important discussion that I think is worth having. I think it's good that no one's saying, well, why are we discussing the robots and artificial intelligence? Because I think it does link to the future trajectory of capitalism. I've just finished writing a master's dissertation, which is like quite a lot about science fiction, which is possibly going to inform a lot of what I'm going to say to a certain extent, which is two things really. First of all, I think it's right when people talk about the human fascination with robots, going back to Frankenstein, that classic novel, but it actually goes back a lot earlier. If you look into kind of the literature earlier than that, it's quite extraordinary even when you read someone like Homer writing 2,000 and more odd years ago, that since he actually writes about, you know, the gods creating these creatures made out of bronze, which will fashion things, which will help us live a better life, and so that made me start to think: why is it there's been this like centuries long human fascination with robots in different forms and kind of artificial intelligence, more just like this new kind of form of it? And I think it goes back to labour on its on. Work and labor, and it's on the one hand it's expressing this idea to want to escape from drudgery, and then on the other hand it's this kind of long-standing tradition of where even the ruling classes like use these kind of robot analogies to kind of even justify things like slavery. So if you kind of read, you look back in Aristotle, he justifies slavery saying, oh, it's a bit like the slaves being an extension of the master's body. And I think this kind of links to the thing about robots and shows why it is an important debate. So the second thing is about utopia and dystopia, because it's tempting to say, you might kind of sit there and think, well, why does it have to be one or the other? Why is it, could it not be somewhere in between? Could it not be this kind of reformist, kind of gradual, evolutionary, Keynesian thing where we maybe... And actually, no. I don't think what's coming out of what was... The more I think about it, it's one thing or the other, and it's, you know, it's either, and I think there's, you know, you maybe wouldn't want to carry this comparison too far, but I think there's the comparison between the robot society and its positive version and its like negative version. It's very, very much like which direction the political crisis I think is going to go now, and I think we want to like to push it in like a positive way and not in a negative way, because it's the more and more you think about like the way 21st century is going, it's that's more kind of greater spectrum of socialism or barbarism, to coin a phrase. And I think the kind of the robots, narcissists. That's a new form of it. Like saying it's either going to be really good or really bad. Quite possibly at some time, the middle option is being squeezed out, I think.
Okay, thank you. After you, comrade, have you?
Hi, I'm Eileen Sheffield. There were three things I thought of. One is that I watch a lot of popular science TV and we keep being told that the human brain is the most complex thing in the entire universe. There's nothing that's complicated. And sort of connecting to how you make decisions, how you use intelligence, apparently people whose glands, emotions are needed for proper decision making, people who are not got that connection between the intellect bit and emotions cannot make proper decisions because they don't understand. And someone tried to give that to a prototype robot to help its decision making, and it became incredibly possessive of the technician. It wouldn't let anyone near him. So and that's more like the second point I'd make is that it's just what they've been making people, more and more people, incredibly poor, and then there is no one to buy the stuff they make. Capitalism is, I don't have quite your vocabulary, but I understood what you said, that you've got to have a market for the stuff to get rich. It's not enough that people need it and could use it. You've got to get rich. So what are they going to do if they've made more and more people have no income from work? Well, they could get destroyers in wars, or there is apparently something being suggested about a basic income so we could go on buying things from them. That apparently has been floated up. I know no more than that. I think the other thing that is, I've got a particular phobia about the idea of nanobots. If you could say something, because things go into your bloodstream and might destroy cancers or things, but I'm wondering what else they might do. So, Elsa, if you could just...
Thank you, comrade. So, after you, I have you in the blue shirt.
Hello. I made a pilgrimage to Prague a couple of years ago. Actually, I didn't go just for this. I went for cheap beer and all sorts of things. But while I was in Prague, I went to visit the grave of Karol Čapek, who is buried in the National Graveyard in Prague, who began... I appreciate what comrades said about the idea of robots going all the way back to classical society, but in Čapek's RUR play, Russum's Universal Robots, you get the first capitalist robot, I think, in which the whole two-thirds of the play is an absolutely brilliant description of capitalism's drive to accumulate, capitalism's drive to produce. And what they're producing in the near future are not just commodities, but actually humans as commodities, not just their labour power, exploiting labour power. They make humans, synthetic humans, who rebel and destroy human society in a revolution, which I think is very, very interesting, but then are stopped from progressing because they don't know how to reproduce themselves. The Earth is teetering on a catastrophe that's only resolved by the robots finding the ability to have emotions as well. The Čapek wasn't a socialist, but he was a quite interesting, far-sighted character. And I think he absorbs certain Marxist concepts in the story of RUR. And I think the next way that culture deals with robots was in the books of Isaac Asimov's short stories about robots, in which they're all predicated on his famous three laws of robotics, which is an attempt, I think, to make technology safe. It's a bourgeois attempt to say, yeah, there is this potential that you've outlined, but don't worry, we can factor in these safeguards, even though most of his work is how the robots then get around the safeguards. They will not harm human. I'm not going to get through three laws. I haven't got time, to be honest, but you get that idea. And the next time, I think, the next wave, if you like, is the Blade Runner argument, in which synthetic humans are specifically created to be labouring units, or sex workers, or entertainment droids, if you like, and they're so similar to us that the whole story about do androids dream of electric sheep? And Blade Runner that came out of it is, how do we know who's a robot and how do we know who's real? And does it matter? And how would we tell, to be honest? Is Deckard a replicant or is he not? And I think all of these are artistic attempts to deal with the aspect of alienated labour, that we create things that therefore stand above and over us in a human form, if you like. And I think the reality is different, isn't it? Because when Paul Mason talks about the revolution, socialism one click at a time, and looks at how marvellous things like smartphones are and computers are and computer hacktivism and the rest of it, he overlooks the much worse aspect about how these things come into being. In China, Apple have to put bars on their factories to stop their workers from committing suicide because of the drive to them doing the repetitive motions to build an iPhone, are imprinted in them. They do it in their sleep. They are so stressed and whatever. This is the brave new world that we're out. Amazon. I work in book distribution. Amazon, if you work for Amazon, you are treated as a robot. You are given, you're tracked wherever you go. They know how many times you go to the toilet. They know exactly sort of the levels of productivity, and they squeeze that every time. And it's a horrible vision of the future. But in Germany, Amazon workers have struck three times and stuck two fingers up to the bosses. And actually, that's something I don't think a robot will ever do.
Sorry, see, capitalism keeps renewing itself and it keeps changing its balances. When I went to university, I got a student grant, which really dates me, which I could live on for a year, and a colour television was the same price, £330. Now, colour televisions are now produced so much automated, the value of that thing has gone right down it's not something of any value. The question is, as capitalism changes, what should we do? I was working in Fleet Street in the 70s and 80s, when new technology was coming into the newspapers. And what did we do? We said, right, you can have new technology, but we want shorter working hours, longer holidays. We got a 32-hour week, we've got a 9-day fortnight, we've got 6 weeks holiday, which is why Murdoch and Thatcher went for us and unfortunately smashed us. And then they said, the lie, the utopian lie, new technology is going to mean all these new newspapers are going to come and, there's going to be this variety in the media. Look at it now. The Independent was one of those things that was coming out with new technology. Look at the Murdoch monopoly in the media now. Come with new technology. So it's not utopian, and it depends on class struggle. And what's happened is that the things that require human labour have changed. You don't require so much human labour to make a colour TV. But looking after people, developing society, the things that are being cut now, looking after old people, looking after sick people, that's being cut, and people's lives are being ruined because it's being cut, and that's what we have to fight for. But there, that's where we really need human labour. A robot cannot comfort somebody who is dying of cancer. That is something that only, thank God when my mother was dying of cancer, there were human beings that we got from social services, people coming around to the house and looking after. That cannot be done by a robot. And we need more and more of that kind of labour, looking after people, bringing up children, educating children, not in classes of 20, in classes of 10 or 6. That's what we want. So that's what we have to fight for. And it's not a question, the changing balance of capitalism, the increasing productivity of these things, the things that are not actually terribly important. The important thing is the fight for proper conditions, shorter hours, more holidays, and more scope for human creativity.
And Michael is going to sum up now for around 10 minutes. So thanks, Michael.
Just briefly, comrades, I'm sorry the robots in the corner didn't get in. They've left. But let me say that I wasn't suggesting when I presented the fully automated society that this was going to be a reality. I was trying to present a hypothetical example to show how Marx's value theory applies to a situation where human labour doesn't operate. And the argument of many of the supporters of the development of robotic technology to the extreme is that that's the situation we could reach. I don't think we'd ever reach that situation because I think the contradictions within capitalism are increasing and are so great that you would never get to that point. We would have an end to this class struggle, and either an end to capitalism or a return to some sort of lower, increased level of barbarism before we got to the position where robots made robots and ruled the world. That situation is purely hypothetical from the point of view of value theory. The contradiction, actually, that capitalism has is between the development of the productive forces, increasing the level of productivity, and the profitability which is appropriated by the capitalists. It's the key contradiction. This is why capitalism is a system that cannot take human beings forward to this level of superabundance where we can spend the time and energy to develop new forms of work, human activity, rather than toil for a small group of people to make a living, which is what we have at the moment. Most of our waking time, and in some places isn't much sleeping time, most of our waking time is toil, not work or human activity that help to develop and enrich our beings. And the situation to change that will not come under capitalism because of the contradiction between the expansion of productivity through capital accumulation and the fact that capitalists must have profit out of that, and the level of profitability must be sustained or increased to achieve that. In fact, the introduction of mechanization in the 19th century, and therefore robots as well, the increase in the amount of mechanization relative to the amount of labor being used, increases that contradiction. So the introduction of robots actually is accelerating the contradiction within capitalism, which is why before we ever get to the point of a superabundant society on robots, we will have a series of crises of capitalist production, which will be of increasing intensity, particularly as they now become global. Remember, the Great Recession is probably the first global crisis of capitalism. Even the Great Depression of the 1930s wasn't that, because capitalism still hadn't extended its tentacles to all parts of the world. And there is still room for capitalism to expand into areas of the world where it can exploit human labor, which is yet to be fully exploited. But the contradiction of increasing mechanization, increasing robots and automation, increases that contradiction and brings that about. Now, whether robots can be have the same level of human, have the same type of human intelligence or human behavior, or could develop such, some people argue that. Alex thinks that that is impossible because human beings are different, wired up differently, have emotions, as one comrade pointed out. Robots just carry out an extension of a series of computations and expand that. I know some technologists argue against that. They say robots can develop these sentient feelings and development. But I don't think it's an issue that we have to worry too much about at this stage. What we have to worry about, as robots are being introduced, and they will be introduced by capitalism, what will the reaction of human beings, or for that matter, the class-conscious human beings? And the key question here is the introduction of technology to lead to the loss of jobs, or is it to reduce the hours of toil? That's the difference. That's the difference. And when we go in the workplace, as a comrade from Norwich says in the insurance company, we're going to have an algorithm which will decide whether the customer takes this insurance at this level or not, and you don't have to just talk to the customer anymore. It just happens. And what you do is go outside the door there and look for another job. I mean, the answer in a class where the class is in control is that we will say, okay, well, we're going to reduce the hours of work for all insurance workers now because the algorithms have taken away some of these tasks. If we don't need quite that many workers to do insurance, although I'm not quite sure how private insurance and travel insurance works under a common ownership society, but we'll leave that aside for the moment, then there'd be other... The whole point of a society where... things are owned in common and people in control of what happens to them, they can begin the programs of retraining and education to do much more useful work, much more interesting work that's been replaced and get rid of all those menial and unnecessary tasks of toil which human beings do at the present. The case is that the majority of us still toil. A very small minority of us have never toiled and never will, until their power is removed. And the amount of time that we don't engage in toil is still relatively small. The advantage of technology and the development of technology, whether it's robots or anything, is in a commonly owned society to reduce the hours of toil and replace them with time for human activity and growth of the human beings as beings that can really develop, not only improve society, but also nature, and to, help other aspects of nature so that we have a society which can really be harmonious and beneficial to everybody. At the moment, we don't have that. The contradiction remains.